Recording for this meeting has begun.
With respect to the private sector, of course, we're going to spend some more time on that this afternoon, so we can look forward to explore that further. But let me move to this table over here, Mark's table.
I think we discussed a lot. It has been discussed what we discussed as well. But I think one of the couple of things that are kind of unique to our table is that we talked about a need not to narrow the options too much and keep the systems in mind and make them as flexible as possible, and also make it intelligent so people are thinking what the consequences are. For example, in the World Fish Site, since that pond or the CR, what is it, CR, CRM, were used for multiple use, for not only for the wild fish breeding stock, but also food production, but also water for drinking and irrigation, is you have to look at what you're doing to the wider environment as well. So if they become more intensified in rice production, use more chemicals, use more fertilizers, will that contaminate that water system that they're also relying on for their water, for their portable water? So I think that we have to make sure that people understand what they're doing and why they're doing
it. And the 19 steps and all that laid out, and you wondered again whether that sort of systemic or the interconnectivity of the issues going on in the community were a part of that analysis. So great. How about our last group over here? Talk loud. Oh, good. Fantastic. And sorry that some of you didn't get to go on the trip. It was a great trip. Huh? A lot of these cruises have those little side trips that are really, really exciting. So, yeah, across the board, just listen to the kinds of things that came out of our discussion yesterday. I mean, clearly it was a nice break, a chance to take a look at our PowerPoints and see what difference they might make in that real world. And some really good conversations that came out of that. The other thing, just to highlight the number of places here, we're talking about forecasting conversations that we're going to be able to have more deeply today, whether it's the private sector around gender, whatever it might be. So in just a minute, we're going to move to our first session. But before we do that, I'm going to again ask Carla to make a very important announcement.
So among the all the emails that you received from me this morning, one of them most recently in the last hour was the link to the webinar that we're going to be hosting this morning. So if you want anybody to hear about the next session on integrating gender and nutrition into CSA, feel free to forward on the email. It has a link. It's a less than one minute process for them to register for the webinar, and then they will be able to hear and see everything that's happening in this room, as well as ask questions to the presenters afterwards. Okay.
Thank you. So with that, I think, Jeannie, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Thanks, Ed. Good morning. So can we get up the title for the session? Yeah. Thank you. So we wanted to welcome, have we started the webinar or is it, we have, all right. So I want to welcome not only everybody in the room, but I also like to welcome the webinar participants this morning to this session. There we go. We kind of have a little bit of a long title here. We like that. Relationships for Resilience, Understanding and Integrating Gender and Nutrition into CSA. And I'm glad to hear that from the small groups, the small group tables that we did this morning, that folks had some observations around gender. I think one of the things we looked at in our small group was sort of the role of gender and also youth and looking at kind of who does what. So we really try to recognize this as a multi-dimensional issue. I'm Jeannie Harvey. I'm the one of the gender advisors for the Bureau for Food Security in Washington, D.C. I work on the technical team under Meredith Sewell. And we're sort of our one of the things that we want to sort of emphasize is USAID's commitment to gender equality and gender issues and sort of tackling gender as a broad issue within within the work that we do. And specifically, that gender is not an add-on. It is not something we do in addition to the work we do. Gender is part of everything we, it's integral into the work we do. So we really want to make sure that people understand that and that cross-cutting does not mean that we can sort of place it in this box somewhere else and it's not part of each one of the IRs, that it's not really part of the whole overall goals and objectives that we have for the program. So I think we want to remember that. And I think we're really going to see that as we look at what the panelists present today. We recognize that these systems are multi-layered, they're complex in nature, they're dependent on context. We've heard that a lot this week already, and I think we will hear that some more today. One of the things that I'm really excited about, well, and also I wanted to also point out too, and I think Sophie may point this out when she speaks, but she put on the tables myths about gender, and I love these cards because, so at each of your tables, I love these cards. Sorry if I'm stealing your thunder, Sophie, but okay. But I think it's really important for us to remember that there's a lot of things that are being, a lot of ideas that are being promoted out there as science and as fact and as research and as evidence-based that actually are not based in evidence. And so we really need to kind of find maybe some of the experts we can and go to them to try to help sort through and sift through some of the data and some of the research that's out there. We're doing a better job of it, I think, you know, really trying to understand what the research and evidence base is for some of the data we get. But women do not produce 90% of the food worldwide. And I think there's some other ones, but, you know, there's lots of those myths that go around. So you're going to hear about a project today called GCAN. And it's really, it's a partnership between USAID and IFPRI to really help missions look at how evidence, how research can help inform how they can hold together all this research from all these various different sources and make sense of it relative to their programming. So the idea is we'd like to help missions to be a little bit more able to use all this mountain of evidence, mountain of research out there in designing their programs, and then how do they really inform it? So I think you're going to be, today you'll hear about a new framework that's being developed. You'll hear from Elizabeth Bryan on the framework. You'll hear from Joelle Schifani on nutrition in research relative to climate smart agriculture. And you'll hear from Sophie Tice on the gender issues related to that. it's a partner, and there are many other partnerships in USAID, and I hope this kind of a conference, a GLEE like this, really allows us the opportunity to kind of pull together some of these partnerships, the partnerships with the CG centers, the partnerships with our implementing partners, and really try to kind of use these partnerships to build on the evidence and to build on the evidence base, and then share that so that we can use that to further our programming. And we look forward to your inputs, thoughts, and suggestions and ideas, and you'll have a chance to kind of give those today, this morning. And I think what I'd like to do is just welcome to have the panelists come up, and I guess you guys can sit over here, you gals can sit over here. So Elizabeth Bryan is going to be, she'll be the first to talk and give you information on the framework, and then Joelle Schifani and Sophie Tice. Okay. Great. So I'm going to introduce Elizabeth now and have her come up. Great. Thank you. Oh, and just remember that we're on the webinar, so I'm going to be with the folks on the webinar if any questions come up, and sharing those questions with you all too.
Thank you, Jeannie, and thanks everybody here for sticking through this very long week and joining us on the last day. We're really excited to share with you what we're doing through this project. And you have already received a vast amount of information about how to integrate this CSA lens into your programming activities. And now we're going to actually try and build in a couple of additional lenses around gender and nutrition. And I think there's already been some really great thinking and discussions about this already. So as Jeannie mentioned, we have a new initiative which started this year. IFPRI is leading it, and Claudia Ringler, who's seated right there, is the project leader, and another colleague of ours, Tim Thomas, who does a lot of climate science work, is also here with us in the room. And this initiative really aims, as Jeannie said, to help the missions integrate thinking around climate smart agriculture and gender and nutrition. And again, we have to think about these things together to really have the most effective programming and to achieve the objectives of the global food security strategy around poverty and nutrition. So that's really one of the key objectives here. And we're not asking for the missions to invest a lot of time. We're here to be a service for you. We're able to pull together all the available data and evidence from your context to try and synthesize it for you and to have conversations with you about what that means for your programming and how you can better integrate that. And to do that, we're in the process of developing a conceptual framework to help guide sort of thinking around these issues and some tools based on the framework that we think, you know, you can use in your own work to help think through this. And then in addition, we also have the capacity to try and do some research around key elements of this framework that may be missing in your context. So the amount of data and existing research varies significantly as you move from country to country. So there may be particular issues that you're concerned about in your country that you just feel like, I don't have enough information, I don't have enough evidence to support my programming on that. And IFPRI can really help dig deeper into those issues. And we're trying to, through this research, better utilize the existing data that we have. You guys all collect these Feed the Future data sets, and a lot of times they're not being utilized to their full potential. So IFPRI can help with that and even sort of visualizing the data that we do have. And, you know, if you have specific questions or, you know,
outcomes to the climate signal, because we want to also keep in mind that a lot of these climate smart approaches have implications for greenhouse gas emissions or carbon sequestration as one of the many environmental outcomes that can occur. And just to quickly illustrate that this is a very generic and general framework, which can be adapted for different country contexts. It can be adapted for different sets of climate smart agriculture approaches. It can also be adapted to look at specific spatial scales. So we've gone ahead and just as an example, we want to look at two different spatial scales. So at the household level and then at the sort of policy or more macro level. And here you can see that we've kind of filled in the different factors that might influence absorptive and adaptive
passive or a household or an individual or community, more of the micro level. And then we've sort of filled in some examples of responses at this particular more micro level. So some of the factors that we think about that influence adaptive and absorptive capacity include things like the livelihood activities of the household, the sort of natural resources that they have access to, infrastructure and institutions, importantly, sort of perceptions of climate change and risk preferences and responding to those changes, things like human and social capital, financial capital and assets, access to markets, et cetera. And again, we've just sort of, this is not an exhaustive list of responses, but we just threw this up as a sort of highlight some of the different approaches that can be taken. And again, you know, some of these can be seen as more coping mechanisms, like borrowing from relatives when there's a shock, or selling assets. Oftentimes, a lot of families have to sell things like livestock, or they have to make changes in consumption, consuming less or consuming different kinds of foods. And those responses are very important for nutritional outcomes. And then there can be more adaptive or transformative practices that help families bounce back, responding, you know, after a shock or stress, or even bounce back better than before. And these can include things like, you know, having access to insurance or making human capital investments. But again, it's going to depend on the context and the actor, and et cetera. And just to move to the next example, you know, at the more macro level, we can think of some of the factors influencing absorptive and adaptive capacity to be things like the structure of the economy, the level of infrastructure of the economy, the kinds of challenges that the country may be facing, such as the level of poverty and inequality, the kind of nutritional burden of the country. And sort of GDP and other resources that the country can draw on to respond to climate change. And as Mark mentioned on Monday, there's lots of different policy responses, and we've been talking about this throughout the week. So I think with that, I'm just going to turn it over to Joelle, who's going to give some more concrete examples of some of the nutritional aspects of this framework in the context of Cambodia. And then Sophie's going to talk about some more specific concrete examples for gender. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
So I'm going
to continue working on the framework. Let me just
So
I'm going to basically discuss considerations for nutrition-sensitive approaches. So back to the framework. Before I go through this, I just want to emphasize one key point that I'm glad was brought up, I think, on Tuesday by Blake from World Fish. He said that we don't necessarily have to keep thinking of nutrition as an outcome. Nutrition is actually an input. Nutrition is what actually drives this entire cycle, nutrition and health. So we always think of nutrition as being what we want to measure at the end. But we have to think of, if we have a healthy population to start with, healthy children to start with, they're going to be physically more productive, economically more productive, and their cognitive developments will be a lot more, will be developed. So we will start off with a healthier population, which will then ease this whole cycle. So let's stop thinking of nutrition as the final product and thinking of it and start thinking of it as what we want to start with, what we want to really invest in.
So these
couple slides are now going to be on the absorptive capacity and adaptive capacity. So there is the census of agriculture that was done in 2013 in Cambodia that wanted to understand where the main sources of food were coming from for all agricultural households. And this slide basically has two main messages. rice and other cereals are mostly produced on people's private lands or on lands that people can access. But all the other types of food are bought from markets. So when we're thinking about diversification, it's important to encourage diversification at the household level, but not forget access to markets and food prices, because this is where people are really getting their food. We are talking about infrastructure. Let's think about climate change and infrastructure. If the physical infrastructure of the country or of the region is not adaptable to floods, if the roads are all messed up, if people cannot go to the market to either sell or buy the food, this is going to have a huge implication on nutrition in terms of protein, in terms of vitamins, in terms of minerals. So let's also think about infrastructure in terms of these things. And food prices, of course, we understand the effect of food prices on consumption and nutritional status. So this is also more about the adaptive capacity. So actually both. They're very interchangeable when it comes to nutrition, which is okay. We just have to understand what this means for our programming. So the census also wanted to look at the various causes of food shortage. Basically, all of these are affected by climate change. Okay, let's look at the greatest one, which is low production of food due to shortage of capital and less land area. So we know climate change affects the area of land that we can work on or access. What about capital? So we know climate change comes with a lot of implications on health. If there's increased water that's stagnant around the area, there's increased risk of infections, which actually affects your health, which affects your ability to work in the field. So we have to really think about this in a larger context. Let's look at more direct implications of climate change. Let's say the third bar, it's crop loss due to heavy rain or drought or calamities of pest. So this slide is basically showing us that climate change really has an impact on nutrition and food shortage in so many different ways. So this is more food security, access to food, availability of food, which then translates into nutrition. But nutrition is not just food security. It's a lot more than that. And I think that's the biggest message that I want to get across today, which I'm very happy was discussed kind of at the back table when we were going over this reflection from yesterday. It's not just about getting access to food. It's not just about one technology. We have to think about this in the bigger picture, which I will discuss. So coping strategies. Let's say there's a shortage of food. What are the main coping strategies that are actually practiced here in Cambodia that are responding to climate change? So we know that the largest coping strategies are borrowing money or securing food on credit. So this increases debt, right? This has further implications on what you can buy in the future, which has implications on your nutritional status. Also, some households have to send a member to go look for work or other sources of income. So less productivity on their own lands. So less food from their own lands. Also, this is a woman. If a woman is having to leave to go work elsewhere, there's less time for her to work at home. So less time for her to care for her children, which we know also affects nutritional status. So all these coping mechanisms and strategies actually may exacerbate the impacts of climate change on nutrition through these different pathways. So we have to understand when we are designing our programs, how can we address these coping strategies to make sure that we're not actually exacerbating this, or maybe we're not leaving these things out. So we're starting to look at value chain approaches. We're trying to understand the whole value chain from inputs all the way to outcomes and nutrition. I'm gonna discuss quickly three ways we can maximize nutrition entering or minimize nutrition leaving these value chains. So yesterday when we went to Erie's site, we saw that Erie is working very hard on improving seed varieties. So this is one great example of how we can maximize nutrition entering the value chain by having crop varieties that are nutritious, that can withstand all the climate change implications that are happening right now. So that's fantastic. Production. Let's think of this in terms of nutrition and women farmers. If women farmers are the ones that are actually producing the food in the fields, what is this? Okay, I don't want to take away too much away from Sophie's slides, but are they getting the access to information that they need to be as productive as they can be? So there's a comment on our table right now that most of the women in the homestead garden, everyone was a woman. So someone was saying, okay, we have to actually tailor our messaging and tailor our technologies to make sure that these women can actually be as effective. So this is one way of really ensuring that the women are productive, which then increases nutrition. Last but not least, and the most important thing, I think everyone here should just, if you remember one thing in my presentation, it's the next few slides. It's really the food utilization. It's actually getting this food to affect nutritional status. Just because your food's secure does not mean you have nutrition security. They're very different. They're related, but they're very different. So I'm going to talk about this in terms of water. So we know water is very important for growing crops. We know water is very important for hand washing behavior. We know water is very important for drinking, right? How do all of these work together to improve nutrition? And how do oftentimes CSA actually negatively impact nutrition through water? So we have to think about the infrastructure that comes along with CSA. I'm going to give you one example. If we have irrigation in our community and we're bringing more water in, and then we have stagnant water lying around, what is this going to cause? If there's a risk of having mosquitoes that are infected with malaria and they breed on these water sites, we're going to increase risk of malaria, which will then increase risk of infection and increase risk of malnutrition, because we understand that infection and malnutrition are very related. That's one example. Another example, if we are bringing water from some foreign source into the community and it's not properly managed, it's either contaminated, or the same water that is being used for cooking is also the water that is being used for washing. Definitely there will be fecal contamination of this water, which is then ingested, which then causes diarrhea, which then causes environmental enteropathy, which prevents someone from absorbing all their nutrients. So even though our CSA practices have the ideas in mind, we have to really make sure that we're managing the resources that the CSA is really bringing into this community. Just an example. So in Cambodia, between 2005 and 2010, there was a significant change in open defecation. So it was reduced due to very good awareness campaigns. And this really by itself,
Just briefly, so I don't go over time. There's also a lot of pathways from women's empowerment to nutrition. So there's some positive effects on nutrition and some negative effects on nutrition when it comes to women's roles and time use in agriculture. So just briefly, one positive effect is women will, if they participate and have options to participate in agriculture, they will get source of income and then improve
negative effects on nutrition. If the women are in the farms and working all day, they don't have enough time to actually care at home. They don't have enough time to make healthy food. And they don't have enough time to feed their children the way they're supposed to or the way anyone is supposed to. If someone doesn't have a partner at home to help her or some cooperative where other women or other men can help her, there's is going to be a lack of translation into nutritional status. Final message, which I'm glad was also mentioned word for word earlier on, there's no one size that fits all. Whether you're in a rural setting or a urban setting, whether you're moderately stunted or severely stunted, there's no one size fits all. If you're severely stunted, the way we treat this is very different than the way we treat someone who's moderately stunted. If we're in a rural area, very different than the way it is in an urban area. So we really have to understand the context that we're working in. Thank you.
Okay, so gender CSA and climate resilience. This is just going to be a very brief taste of the evidence that's out there. A few entry points for programming, and as you'll see, I'm very passionate about this and would be delighted to talk to people about this afterwards if this piques your appetite. So there's already excellent initiatives on gender mainstreaming, women's empowerment across all the programs that are here. I want to acknowledge this to start out with. This presentation might include some things you already know. I think the main contribution that we're trying to get to here is to think through conceptually how gender and CSA are linked. We're not introducing a new set of requirements, but really thinking about how these things meet one another and how we might consider them in our programming. So why gender for climate resilience? We've talked a lot throughout this week about the importance of tailoring services and products for the population that we're trying to serve. We can't do that if we don't understand the differences within this population based on gender, based on other forms of social identity. So this is a basic approach to ensure social inclusion. CSA also has the potential for risk or to exacerbate inequality, so we need to be looking at differences across the population to understand, to capture and understand and then mitigate harm to the most vulnerable. It's also a missed opportunity if we don't do participatory development, right? If we assume that men speak for women or if we assume that, you know, some women speak for all women within a population. There are very specific sets of knowledge, networks, and skills, especially on climate adaptation, that farmers that we work with can contribute to technologies and to the design of services. And we need to understand how actors will respond to the programs that we're rolling out in order to see how they will carry forward the development outcomes for which they're so instrumental. So the time use question, how a program might affect women's time can have major implications on her ability to provide care and secure nutrition for herself and for her household. So when we were, you know, we're looking forward to your feedback on this framework. When we've shopped it around, people said this is good, but I thought this was on gender. Where's the gender in this framework? So it's not immediately obvious at first glance, but it's essential to this, the way this these pathways here bring about resilience. So I'm going to make the invisible more visible here. There's a vast body of literature on major gender inequalities in agriculture. Many of these relate to differences in absorptive and adaptive capacity. So human capital, social capital, financial capital. I'm not going to go into all of the literature on this, but these translate into really significant differences in some contexts for men and women to absorb and adapt to climate. The decision-making context conveys important differences in preferences and also the power to act upon those preferences, both within the household and at the community level. As I mentioned a slide before, men and women will have different influence on the impact pathways. And then the impacts themselves are distributed unequally within a household. I think it bears repeating, and I think most of us are on the same page as this, but the myth of the unitary household, where all resources and all information are shared sort of uniformly within, between all household members, that's been busted in the 90s. So this is, individuals within the household will have very different elements of each of these frameworks and experience it differently. And it's really valuable to our programming to highlight that. So in this quick presentation, I'm just going to focus on adaptive capacity, the decision-making context, and the distribution of outcomes of CSA or impacts of CSA on men and women. In the context of CSA, adaptive capacity really represents like key prerequisites for being able to access CSA and benefit from CSA. To access CSA, I would say. The decision-making context represents a realm of how you can benefit from CSA, and then the outcomes are sort of how you're impacted, whether by CSA, including benefits. And there's a fairly there's good evidence for absorptive capacity, adaptive capacity in general. I think one point I want to make in this presentation is that even though we understand some of the we understand many of the constraints and linkages in general, it still is really valuable to look at the specific context where you're working, test some of these things that are relevant in other places, and see what's most important with the population that you're working with. Okay, so this is a really interesting study in Bangladesh. Men and women were asked, where do you get your agricultural and climate information? Red in bold indicates significant differences. So if you're hoping to reach women through traditional sources of agricultural information, like extension services or agricultural service providers, good luck. It's not reaching them. It's not really reaching men very well either, but it is a little bit. So that's good to keep in mind, that these channels are not always so effective for everybody. Even the group-based sources are not really working well in this context. Surprisingly, women do receive more information from informal sources in the form of neighbors and also from the radio. And I think, to me, the most surprising aspect of this, of all these findings here, is that family members, pretty low. So the idea that you can train one family member, the husband, for example, and expect him to come back and share what he learned with everybody else, it's not always going to happen. So let's not operate on that assumption. Let's actually make sure information is reaching both men and women. So information is really important for adoption. It's not the only thing, but it's a really key prerequisite. And we find here that awareness is really different. There's major gender gaps across most CSA practices asked here. Men are more aware than women of these practices. However, if you just ask people who were already aware of these practices if they actually adopted it in the last year, you see less of a gender gap across fewer of the practices. And in fact, women are more likely than men in one CSA practice, which is improved livestock feed management. That's consistent with gender roles in Bangladesh and sort of indicates that they're willing to adopt, they're willing to take risks. Women are innovators. But access to information is a major barrier, and it's not just the channel of information, but the content. If it's about something that they take care of, something that they're already working in, they're more likely to do something about it. So to take this forward, just a very simple couple of considerations for thinking about how to really properly tailor climate information, advisory, and extension services for both men and women. First of all, we can ask ourselves, okay, this is like a little mental checklist. Does it reach men and women? What's the channel? What are the channels that men and women are accessing information? What networks, social networks, are they actually involved in? Can they go to a public space and learn about sort of within a single value chain of one crop or one livestock, different roles that men and women play, weeding or post-harvest processing, and also domestic responsibilities? And then we need to ask, is it actionable for recipients? Is this information actually something people can act on?
given the other constraints that they face. More research in the bottom here that we can talk about later. Okay, second quick example, and by the way, we're just talking about time and information here because these are both essential for CSA, and in most contexts where we've worked, they represent a major constraint to adoption. So we all know that women shoulder really heavy time burden given their triple roles in caregiving, agricultural production, and domestic responsibilities. This is especially true in Asia with such high male out-migration and a high dependency ratio. On top of this, hiring labor can be more difficult for women because of social norms. I've talked to many women that say, they won't work for us. They don't respect us as supervisors. And these basically pose a constraint for adopting certain CSA practices that require labor or require more time availability, and even to learn about these practices in the first place. And there's a whole litany of possible programming approaches that can be, there's many different angles you can take with this because there's so many different things that women do many, aspects of many chores that could be, have their drudgery reduced. There's a lot of rich data in the population-based surveys from Feed the Future countries. This is some analysis from a paper that we did on women's time use and nutrition last year. Basically, this is just showing that the darker colors are men, the lighter colors are women from Bangladesh, Cambodia, Nepal. And just shows in the last 12 months that both men and women really worked across a range of economic activities, cash crop farming, food crop farming, livestock raising, wage work, et cetera. And in addition to economic activities, women are also heavily involved, no surprise, in sort of the category of reproductive work. So that includes domestic chores, fetching water, firewood, cleaning the house, cooking, care. And also agriculture and non-agricultural work. So who's from Nepal here? You guys work really hard. So this is in red and pink here. Oh, sorry, pink is Nepali women, which work almost 11 hours a day. That's a lot in total. And the men, they're still up there. They're like amongst the highest at 8 hours. But there's an important gender gap in sort of total work when you look at all of this together. And major time, this is just to show sort of major time burden on women. Okay, looking at the decision-making context. So all the response options we saw, they're embedded within different power structures and venues for decisions. Men and women often have different preferences and needs related to responding to climate change based on what they prioritize, what their own roles are. And in many of the spheres in which they work, they don't have the power to act upon those priorities. I think in Cambodia, it seems like, at least anecdotally, there's a lot of support for the idea that women have, strong roles in household financial management and decision making. But as they mentioned, as this group mentioned in the morning, this doesn't necessarily translate into more public spheres. So Cambodia has this amazing decentralization going on with lots of community-based adaptation measures. There are provisions to include women, but in practice, this is not really happening. Either women aren't showing up, or they're not speaking in public, or they're not taking on leadership roles, or they're not really participating in the decisions that actually matter, which can sometimes be informal. I would add to this that, participation in formal organizations is often very low or not influential by women. And also in informal networks that are so important for climate adaptation, so informal labor exchanges or lending. In some cases, women aren't able to partake in that because they're expected to not be able to reciprocate. Often we sort of try and solve this question by just collecting sex disaggregated indicators about who's participating. That's important, but I think we can, without that much difficulty, do a better job than that. So actually looking at what roles people are playing, what value they found in participating, how often they spoke and actually contributed in a meaningful way. So finally, I think the question that we need to pose to ourselves is, can we design CSA in a way that will close gender inequalities, or is what we're doing actually exacerbating inequalities that are already at play in the societies where we're working? I think important to this is to recognize that the costs and benefits of climate responses, including CSA, are not distributed uniformly
within the household. So not between husband and wife equally, not between different ages as well. Some questions that we can be asking to, put a finer point on these costs and benefits. You know, it's not just in terms of income, but some of these other things. So time use change, control over income, which is quite complicated. We can talk about that later, but important in different ways you can measure that. Who gains and loses assets in case of a shock? Whose assets are sold? How does that change their bargaining power and resilience into the future? If you have to pull a child out of school or you don't have access to health services, who is more impacted by these changes in human capital investments? Changes in consumption patterns and sort of exposure to health risks, like being, you know, working more with aflatoxin contaminated crops or being sort of, you know, more exposed to malaria risks. So these are like possible things that, you know, it might be the case that these are, there's more equitable distribution of costs and benefits. It's certainly possible. We're not saying that it's always extremely unequal, but you don't know unless you're conducting good sex and age and wealth disaggregated M&E and across a range of impacts that you aren't necessarily in your theory of change or aren't intended impacts. Yeah. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you, Sophie. I'm not going to go through the key takeaways. These are basically just some of the highlights that we've already discussed in the presentations, and we're a little bit over the time that we wanted to allocate to speaking. And we're going to move into a small group activity. And I'm going to ask you guys to get up and move around a little bit. So we want to talk about some key aspects of this framework in small groups. And we also want to get feedback from you guys on, so, you know, now that you've heard all of these different lenses about gender, nutrition, and CSA, what are your programming ideas for how to integrate that? And what are some of the key questions and evidence gaps that are remaining that you think that IFPRI can help you with in your work and in your country context? So it's probably best if we organize around the missions that are here. I think there are 9 missions. So if you're from a mission, can you stand up, please? And we'll see where you are. And then we're going to ask each mission to sort of take a table. And those of you who are here who are not from a mission, please join the mission table that you feel is that you can contribute to or that you want to contribute to or learn more about. So that way we can have 9 different tables. And so if you're from a mission, can you just call out where you are and we'll put a little place card at your table so that everyone knows where they can go. And I'm going to hand out, while you guys are doing that, I'm going to go around then and hand out a little note card where we want you to kind of, you know, after you have your discussions, have somebody sort of jot down what are some of the key takeaways, you know, 3 or so points per question that you talked about at your table. And, you know, these are a lot of questions here, so we've kind of divided them up amongst different groups. So group A is going to get the top question and then the 2 bottom questions. Group B is going to get that middle question and then the 2 bottom questions and so on. So on your note card, you'll have the questions that we want your group to handle. And I'm going to go hand those out now. And in the meantime, Jeannie's going to be taking questions or compiling questions from the webinar, and then we can take those at the end. Okay, sorry, Ed was just right to point out that we do have people from Burma here, and so we can create another table for that as well. Yeah.
Hi. Sorry. One more thing. There's actually at the center of your table, there's this incorporating gender and nutrition within CSA checklist. So you can look at this also to use as some questions to look at to stimulate your conversation. And Sophie and others are coming around with a one sheet for each of you that has your question, and we're asked you to take notes on these discussions.